Today we're going to talk about the meditative aspect of the bachelor program, of the IOC Daoland program. The reason for this is actually twofold. First of all, the meditative program from the bachelor and the master program is quite extensive. And second of all, a part of these meditations are also going to be available as fast tracks. I'm working on developing these fast tracks so that everybody basically can do that. The only thing is that because of the bachelor program, because of the master program, you get to get a lot more information and a lot more depth in your practice to make sure that you also can transfer this in your teachings to other people. So what I think that is important, the origins of these meditations are from the priestly kind of training that I got from Master Liu, and in how far that got confirmed by discussions with Taoists in Wudang and Qingshanshan in the past, and also by Sifu Yao Xuande when I was talking with him about these kind of things. And in general, we can say they fall apart in four broad categories. The first category is, of course, the foundation. And the second category is what is called the minor circulations. And the third category is the grand circulations, you might say. And this is about a more deep practice. And then the fourth category is what is called high practice. And they belong to different kind of schools in some way, and they're intertwined. And I got practices from people from Longman Taoism, from Zhengyi Taoism, and from Wudang Taoism. And the similarities and the overlap between them was very large. My teacher Liu, he always used the Zhongwu Qigong as a foundation to teach all these things. So that's also why I used the Zhongwu Qigong as a foundation for the bachelor and the master program, because there's so much in it. And what you see with the Zhongwu Qigong and the meditation in respect to each other is that the Zhongwu Qigong, the circulations, and the organ-directed practices, meditations, they all form a unity. And you might take the Korean flag as a role model for how they are intertwined with each other. And in the Korean flag, you have the three different kind of colors that are intertwined like fishes, just like a yin-yang symbol, but then with three factors. When we talk about the first category, then we can say that there is the absolute foundation, of course, and it is settling your foundation through Dantian practice. Dantian practice in itself is not very difficult, although there's different ways of doing that. But in general, in the way how I approach that and how my teachers all approach that is to follow a sort of natural way. The thing is through discipline and patience and repetitive practice, certain kind of effects come about by nature. Yes, by allowing these things to naturally come out, you have the best results. And this is what we use in the practice. So there's things that are like pseudo effects that you can do through forced practice. And it feels like, you know, you really achieved something, you really mastered something. But the real effect comes from when it is natural, because that's what you need to become an immortal. And that is the same in all Taoist schools. Just sitting, holding your attention in the Dantian, achieving stillness, building the foundation in activating basically the Dantian and understanding what the Dantian actually is. So it's not just a point or an energy thing or something like this, but it actually is a set of functions. And these functions you want to build on. Then the second one is the Yuanqi meditation. They belong to the same category. In the Yuanqi meditation, you bring the Yang Qi from heaven and Yin Qi from earth, which are all both very extensive and permanent and wide qualities. You bring them together through the only access that you have for that in your body, and then you merge them and you revert heaven and earth back to Yuan Qi. And the Yuan Qi itself cannot be controlled by a person, and then at that moment it becomes whatever you program it with, and that is your cultivation. That's part of your cultivation, is learning how to guide that process into becoming something, like getting yourself a new Mercedes or something. Of course, that's not really what it is about. But there might be people who would like to have a Mercedes. Then the third one is Lingxun meditation. Lingxun meditation, I got confused about it in the beginning stage of this practice when I learned it. And then when I learned it, my teacher Liu first showed me, and then I learned it from Shen Hongsun, another one, and I learned from Master He and Master Li, and from Longmen Taoism, and I learned with several other people practices that relate to this, and I found in Western translation basically nothing about it. There was very little talk about it. And when I talked it over with my friend Chang Xin, who was at that time anyway professor at Tsinghua University teaching Taoist studies. And at that time, he linked it for me to fashion practice. And he said, like, well, you know, these kind of things are interrelated. So I started changing the teachings in my own program and school to make that more clear. Lingxun and fashion is not the same. But they are related. They are slightly differing traditions. They are, in some ways they are the same, in other ways they are different. Fashion maybe is a little bit more bland than the Lingxun practice. My Sifu Yao Shende, when I was there the fifth year, he gave a lecture for the students and also for national TV that was coming to the monastery, and I think it was the third year actually. Anyway, doesn't really matter which year it was. He gave a lecture, and then I realized at a certain point, like, ah, now you're talking about Lingxun practice. So I asked him about it, some questions. He was very surprised that a foreigner would know about it, because he never heard a foreigner know about it, and the most Chinese also don't know about it. So the people from the TV and the other monks, they were looking a little bit riddled, like, what are you talking about? So this is a very important practice, which according to Yao Shunde is required to become an immortal, because Lingxun is actually also what is promoted in Lingbao Taoism, and because of the translation of the character, retranslation of the character in the simplification process, the meaning changed, but originally it is the way how you develop affinity between you and the universe, so that's a unity. What is called Taiyi. Taiyi and the universe and you and the world around you come into a harmonious peace, Taiping, so that you develop a continuous, how do you say, harmony with things. Even though things go wrong, you stay in harmony. That's basically it. It doesn't prevent that things go wrong, of course. Then the second category, which we call the minor circles, is what usually is called Xiao Chou Tian and Da Chou Tian and Long. Long, what's the name again? Hu Xi Long Fa. This is a dragon breath practice. And the small heavenly circle, the Xiao Chou Tian. This is what is usually known as the circulation of Yang Qi in the Dumai, in the Yin Qi in the Renmai. And this is what is also often referred to as the rotation of steam and dew. At the moment when you go to the follow-up of this, you go to what is called the large heavenly circle. And this is basically the spreading of the Yang Qi and the Yin Qi through the Yang and the Yin channels and the body, and that means that the Yang Qi actually rotates, and then whatever is left then completes the small heavenly circle. So you see that the small heavenly circle has two stages. One is the regular stage, and then you have the spread out in the long circle, and then it completes in the small heavenly circle by whatever happens through the large circle. Then the third one in this category, that's actually the sixth from the whole package, is called the Dragon Breath Practice. And the Dragon Breath Practice comes in two stages, basically. One is the purification stage, and the second one is the cultivation stage. So these two things, they relate to the environmental chis, and they relate to the powers of nature, which is called the dragon practice, of course, because the big powers in nature, they're all dragons. And I've heard somebody say a while ago that dragons live in your heart and they make you sick and stuff like this. This is just sick. It's just stupid to say that, because that means that the Western concept of dragons has been infiltrating the Chinese concept of dragons, because in the West, dragons are evil, and in Chinese culture and Asian cultures, they're just powerful. And so that is, of course, very important, because the acquisition of power is part of the Taoist practice, and for health practice, it's the same. So, if I look at the two stages so far that we discussed, the first one, the settled thing, make sure that you develop the right kind of relationships with things in the universe, that you can see the things for what they are. This is a very important part of Taoist practice, but it's also a very important part in health practice, because you have to develop what Michel Foucault calls the medical gaze. You have to be able to see the things for what they are, and not try to make up things because of following your opinions. This is something that also was in the West very important as part of the work of Leonardo da Vinci, who also said, as an artist, you have to develop a particular way of looking at things, and you have to be able to look at things from different ways. And this is something that you also find back in Greek philosophy, and even Jewish philosophy and religiosity and stuff like this, and Christianity as a whole, that there has to be a certain kind of rationality, which is in essence not personal. It has a relatively abstract. But to get to that point, you need skills. Then at the moment when you have these basic skills, you can start developing particular kind of qualities inside yourself. And these circulations are part of developing these kind of qualities, so that the body starts feeling healthy and more empowered and stuff like this. And it helps you to live longer and to have more vitality, so that you can do more things, so that you do not feel hindered by things like hunger or tiredness and confused emotions and so on and so forth. Because all these things, they are in the way to become a good practitioner in medicine. This is something that Sun Simiao and other people like this god of medicine all emphasized. And even Hua Tou, he emphasized how important it is that you have a good understanding of nature before you understand anything about health. And he described in his book, the Book of Hua Tou, he described basically how miserable people are at the moment when they are sick, and that you, as a medicine person, as a healer, you have to live within this misery. And Sun Simiao also, he said that your inward presence has to be pure enough so that you do not get affected by all the negativity from the diseases from the people around you. And as a Taoist, also the same. Even though people pull back into hermitage and they dress up in beautiful clothing and they do all kinds of things, in essence, they have to become good people. And good people are people who are living in the service of other people, and they don't do anything for themselves. So they have to let go of all vanity. That's why Taoists, they usually wear poor, sloppy clothing when they are serious, and when they do it for the prestige, they have beautifully kempt hairs, and they have nice trimmed beards and beautiful clothing with nice decorations on it, and they have all the nice implements and stuff like this, because either somebody gives that to them, or because anyway they like to wear it. And you see the same in Buddhism. I remember Buddhist Lama, that was a good friend of mine, he says, like, yeah, I have to wear this golden watch because my donators, they give it to me, and they will be insulted if I don't wear it. But the thing is that they give it to you so that you can sell it, so that you can give it to good causes. We come to the third category, and this is where it becomes actually more complicated, because now we are getting more and more into the realm where the theory that is required to be able to do it right has to be really correct. And there is a certain kind of way of translating that has to be abandoned to be able to understand what is the practice actually all about. So this third category also again has three parts, and one is what is called Wu Tang Yin and Yang circulation. And the Wu Tang are the five internal organs, and then the way how the yin and the yang circulate within them, helps you to understand Wuxing theory. And without this practice, Wuxing theory is just an abstraction in your mind. And so that means you don't really understand what the Wuzhang is about. And without understanding what the Wuzhang is about, how can you ever treat a person and actually know that you are right? You can notice at a certain point, like the 60% rule that the World Health Organization uses. You can at a certain point know, like, okay, this person is not going to have too many complaints, but it doesn't mean that the problem is being resolved. And the whole program of the Daoland program, and the whole plan behind the Daoland program, is to provide skills from the worst situation to the most ideal situation, and people can float in between there, and you as a practitioner also the same way, you float in between there. And then this Wuzhang Yin Yang circulation is not a very complicated thing, but you have to have done the dragon breath breathing to be able to do it, because otherwise it doesn't make any sense. The connection with the Wuzhang is not good enough. So you see that these things follow up on each other. But in general, you can say these practices, they can be done separate from each other, but they all require each other. So within a certain time frame, and I usually take 2 to 4 years for that for people, they have to learn all these different kind of skills. And then, say, with 5 years, they should be able to graduate from the master program. And then when they graduate, they should be able to do all these kind of things so that they can actually provide a good service to other people as a good Taoist, or as a good Taolander, or as a good healer, or as a good medicine person, or whatever they want to be, right? I'm not going to oblige you to be anything. Then the next one is what is called the 12 channel practice and the 360 point practice. Originally in Chinese medicine, the channels and the points there form two different systems. And you can see that in your anatomy and physiology, which is at the foundation of all these practices. Without the module for anatomy and physiology and all the different kind of levels of theory that is in there, these practices don't make much sense. But the 12 channel practice is just the 12 regular channels. And the 12 regular channels is the collecting channels for the whole body. And the whole body is a whole bunch of channels, and they all come together, and these 12 channels, they circulate in a particular kind of way. But the location is very important, because they are the framework for understanding the rest of the body in another way. And then the 360 point meditations, these are based on getting to know the acupuncture points of the body and how they relate with their channels and what is their function within that therapeutic framework. So learning that kind of skill, certainly in the master studies, is a very important part, because your acupuncture is based on that. So you really has to learn that. And then there is the 78 channel practice, which goes a few steps further, because then the 12 channel circulation has to have acquired that kind of quality and realism and reality, so that you can start noticing the effect of what you're doing throughout the whole of the body. And this is the two different kind of things that come together at the same time. And then the next part is the fourth category. This is where it becomes really more complicated, and without proper preparation, people usually have very little effect of it, except when they do energy work, because then, of course, everything only is in the imagination. And then, of course, when everything is in the imagination, you're always great. The first one is what is called the Sixfu Changwei Clearing. And the Sixfu Changwei Clearing is basically the unblocking from your intestinal flow and to make sure that all the organs are in the right place. So this is not just a meditation, it's actually an active participation in the reorganization of your physical body, as are all the other practices actually. And then the next one is what is called the five tongue practice, and this has to do with the development of the qi and the yang and the yin of the different tongue organs, so that they can do their work better and that they have a better placement inside your body. And then the 12th one, the third one from this category, is what is called the communication with the Wuzhang Shen, and that means the five gods of the body. And the Wuzhang Shen practice in itself is connected to another thing, namely the five dragon practice, but also can be associated with another practice that have to do with the gods of the four directions, the four directional godheads. And that is a practice that goes even further, because then you gradually go towards the practice of the three purities, the three pures. And that one you need to go do astral travel and stuff like this in a secure environment where you can control the outcome of your practice and not being just shot in all directions and just let things happen whatever happens. Because all the things in practice, they all have all kind of effects, but to be controlling them is usually very difficult and takes time. Also the dream yoga, you already get more lucid in your dreams because of all doing all these kind of practices. And at that moment you start getting more clear in your lucid dreams. And then of course as a 13th practice, that is the actual practice, is where everything comes together, and this is the real cultivation process. So the learning process, the learning process for your therapeutic work and for the Taoist work to a large degree is the same. You need all these kind of skills. Hope you enjoyed today, and see you next time.